faith. Words cannot comprehend how mighty you are, Jesus. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we give you glory. Open your mouth and begin to say, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, we give you glory. Starting from this year, Lord, we know how you've been with us. Let's open our mouth and be grateful. If not for anything, for the fact that you're alive this morning. For the fact that you're among the living, giving praises to his holy name.
Thank you. Thank you. Restoration, and this morning we'll be ministering faithfulness of God, and faithfulness to restore unto us all that we have lost in time past. I pray that the Lord bless us even as we listen in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you.
Somebody, don't write off yourself, don't write off your story, that the year is gone and there's nothing good that you can achieve again this year. May I want somebody not to write off the story of your life, that there's nothing good that can happen again in 2020. May I want somebody not to say that 2020 has been a disaster, I can't wait for 2020 to end. May I say to somebody, never, 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 with your mouth confess and say that 2020 has been a miserable year for me, and I cannot wait for this 2020 to end. May I say that the faith should arise in somebody, and let this person change his or her tongue and his or her speech, and begin to confess that certainly I will pursue, I will overtake, and I will certainly recover all. In the name of Jesus, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. May I say to somebody, your beginning might be small, but certainly your latter end shall greatly multiply. See the spirit of the Lord. May I say to somebody, you may think that 2020 has delivered unto you failure, lack, inability to progress, and all sorts of negative things. You may say 2020 has dealt you a bad blow, but by the word of the Lord, the Bible says, He crowned the years with His goodness, and His path drops abundance. May I declare by the word of the Lord, your year shall be crowned with His goodness. 2020 will end for you gloriously. May 2020 shall end for you gloriously. I see you arise again. What 10 months are taken from you, in these last 2 months, you take delivery of them. You take delivery of them. In the name of Jesus. I see the fulfillment of the scriptures. The Lord is giving to somebody a garment of praise instead of the spirit of heaviness. The oil of joy instead of mourning. I see somebody receiving a dance step to dance. I don't know who that person is, but I see a dance step of dancing. Yes, somebody whose faith level will arise to what God is saying this morning. May I give a word of prophecy to somebody, and may somebody's faith arise to connect to that prophecy. By the word of the Lord, by the word of prophecy, and by the word of revelation, 2020 will not end until your promotion is delivered. Joseph said, you meant it for evil, but by divine orchestration, God turned it for good. The devil meant 2020 for evil, but by divine orchestration, I want to prophesy to somebody, listen to me, and I thank God it's been recorded. You would by December 31st, 2025, I have not experienced a better year than 2020. What the Lord will do in this less than 60 days, the business that you encounter, the promotion that you encounter, the business encounter, men of honor, men of timber, men of caliber that you will encounter in this less than 60 days will make up for the past 10 months in the name of Jesus. By the word of the Lord. It looked as though everybody had gone ahead. It looked as though David had been forgotten in the backside of the desert. It looked as though that all the elder brothers of David were making it and doing well, and they were the limelight because they were enlisted into the king's army. They were the elites. They were the royal army in the king's army. And they were the ones working with the king. And David seemed to. But in a twinkle of an eye, in one day, not 7 days, not 1 month, in one day, one calendar day, David went into the array and defeated Goliath. And all of a sudden, every searchlight left all his elder brothers, and even the king, the searchlight left the king, and the searchlight came upon David, and the women began to sing his praise, and nobody or even the king remember that there was such people called the elder brothers of David. In one day, if God turned the testimony of David in one day, 60 days is too much for God. That is why I know that you are coming from the backside of the desert, you are coming to the limelight. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. That is why I know that there shall be a restoration for you. Amen. Not just ordinary restoration, a divine restoration. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Come into your limelight. Amen. Come into your glory. Amen. Come into your success. Amen. Come into your abundance. In the name of Jesus. Amen. It's not too late. God is never late.
Yes, sir.
Martha Mary said, oh Jesus, if thou had come earlier, your friend, our brother, would not have died. Jesus said, who told you I came late? How dare you say I came late? You do not realize that I am the resurrection. I am life itself. Death is not permitted. Where I am a carrier of life. I am life itself. May I speak to somebody who thinks his business is dead? May I speak to somebody who thinks his brain is dead? May I speak to somebody who thinks that he's in a state of comatose? Jesus, who is life himself, is not a carrier of life, he's life. May I say that this Jesus steps into your situation today? This is life into you. I don't know who this person is, but there's a strong urge for me to speak to you. You think that you have lost it because your opportunity was supposed to come earlier this year and that opportunity did not happen, and you have concluded that I'll wait till 2021. The Spirit of God says to me, do not wait till 2021. This 2020 is when I promise you, and I'm still able, and I will bring to pass that which I promised you, says the Spirit of the Lord.
Oh,
tempted. You say in your heart, oh Lord, when will my turn come? You doubt your heart and you wonder, but God, I serve you to the best of my ability. But why does it seem as if that I always encounter failure at the edge of success? And why is it that just as when it's about to be my turn, things turn around and then I miss it? But God will have to say to you, remove the doubt in your heart. Remove the fear and apprehension in your heart. Let your faith be strong, because your doubt and apprehension hinders my move in your life, says the Spirit of the Lord. Remove the doubt, remove the anxiety, hold on unto me, and watch me fulfill all things concerning you, especially your academics, says the Spirit of the Lord. I will raise help from where you least expect, says the Lord. Where your academics are concerned, I, the Lord, will make a way for you. And to be glaring and obvious that only I could have done it, and all the glory and honor will come to me. Because when you have kept your eyes, when you have looked unto men, men have always disappointed, but look unto me. Keep your focus on me, said the Lord, and I will do it, said the Spirit of the Lord. God is God, he's not man. He's not man. He does not repent of what he says. He's not a man to lie, neither the Son of Man to repent of his words. As he said, he will not do it. As he spoke, he will not bring it to pass. Let faith, all I ask of you, brethren, this morning, let faith arise in you. Let faith connect to the move of God, and let it be unto you that is able to do what he said he will do. Truly, you are saying, God, inoculate my faith. I need a boost or a booster. My faith, I know that I should have it, but I'm struggling. I'm seriously struggling. Because the challenges of life are so overwhelming that I'm not saying that my faith is strong enough to weather the challenges of life. I'm not sure my faith is strong enough to believe you for the next level. And Lord, I just need you to inoculate my faith. I need you to give me a faith booster. If you don't mind, can you go on your knees and just say to God, I sense that God wants to visit us this morning and help us to go through the issues of life. Just go on your knees and say, Lord, I need a faith booster, because I know I need to have faith, but Lord, help my unbelief. I need a boost to my faith.
Thank you. kneeling down. Listen to this. One of the people kneeling down, he said to God, God, if you do this thing before 31st of December, on the crossover night, I will come and roll for you. If you will do it, if you say, if you can and you will, before the end of this month, that which I have longed and desired of you for, before you, if you do it, by 31st of December, crossover night, oh, for you. And God will have me say, I take your challenge. I take your challenge. That person should know certainly that that whole, where God is concerned, certainly, certainly, God cannot play that challenge. God definitely cannot play that challenge. So be rest. However, if you not stray in that path, be rest assured that it's a done deal. Father, we thank you. We need to go into the world, mindful of time. But I just need faith to arise in people here this morning. I need you to understand that God is in the business of restoring. God is still in the business of restoring. And I see God restoring us back to our high levels in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your word. We are persuaded that you who have said to do, you will do. You will do only what you are proposed to do. And Lord, before the foundations of the earth were laid, you were. When the earth is removed, you still will be. And we are persuaded, therefore, that what you have said you will do, you are able to do, and you will do. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, O God, because there shall be total restoration. In the name of Jesus. Jam your hands together for the Lord. Give him praise, give him glory, give him honor. I am persuaded this morning. I think all I ask of you, brethren, is for your faith to arise. That's all I ask of you. Let your faith level be high. You see this young man? He has no worries in this world. The man is just, be like a child. That's why the Bible says that if you have been like a child, children have no qualms, no worries in this world. Ask this young man now, is there anything called recession? He has no clue. When he's hungry, all he has to do is, and God help the mom, he doesn't produce food. Why can't we be like children again? And know that God is able to take care of us. Why do we carry our cares with committed to God? I say, God, bring back some of the care I gave you. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Why do we entrust it to God's hands? And then we'll go back again. By worry, that's what worry does. Worry goes to God and say, God, are you sure this thing I gave you? Are you really sure you can? Are you sure you can? Maybe it's too much for you. Let me take some of it. Let me take part of it. That's what worry does. Cast all your cares upon me, for I care for you. But we cast and we'll go back and try and ask God for some of it. I know it's not easy. I know we are human beings, right? But can we just learn, like the child, to trust? Just to trust. Just to trust. And just in a reckless abandon, believe God that is able to do the best. That whatever the outcome is, it is the best, right? Can we just try that? Can we just try that? And know that God is able to do that which he has promised. Don't go collecting it back from him. When we worry, God says that, Kai, does this my child think that I'm not able? That's what happens.
2 Kings chapter 8 verse 1 to 6. Divine restoration. This is our season of divine restoration as declared by the word of the Lord. 2 Kings chapter 8 verse 1 to 6. Divine restoration. Divine restoration through the God servant. This month has been declared our month or a season of divine restoration. 2 Kings chapter 8 verse 6 verses. Are you there? How many people brought Bible to church? How many people brought their phones to church? Are you there? Then spake Elisha unto the woman, whose son he had restored to life, saying, Arise, go thou and thine household, and sojourn wheresoever thou canst sojourn. For the Lord hath called for a famine, and it shall also come upon the land 7 years. How many years?
7 years.
How many years?
7 years.
How many months? 7 times 12. How many months?
84 months.
Hello, no mathematician in the house.
84 months.
Even my daughter with first class.
84 months.
Okay. How many weeks? Oh yeah, bring your phone and bring your computer. How many weeks? 84 times?
364 weeks.
Ah. 364 weeks. How many days? Nobody has phone to do calculator. Mr. Bayo is calculating from his head. Wow, awesome. I'm getting somewhere. How many days? Sorry?
4,555 days.
4,555 days. Okay, say 4,500 days. So, there was famine in the land for 4,500 days. Follow me. And the woman arose and did after the saying of the man of God, and she went with her household and sojourned in the land of the Philistines 5,400 days. So the woman obeyed and left her land, left her possession, left everything, and went to a foreign land to sojourn. Because God, through the man, through the servant of God, has said that there will be famine for 7 years. And it came to pass at the 7 years' end, that woman returned out of the land of the Philistines, and she went forth to cry unto the king for her house and for her land. Question. Who left the land? Hello? Talk to me. I need you guys to talk to me.
Man and her son.
And her son. Who pushed her out of the land?
The prophet.
No. The prophet only prophesied an instruction. Who pushed her? Who forced her out of the land? Nobody. Nobody. She went of her own accord. Hello? Abby? No. I need you guys to follow me. The prophet said leave because there's famine. And she left. She could have decided not to go. Right?
Yes, sir.
So, was she forced out of the land?
No.
She went of her accord in obedience to the prophet. Right?
Yes.
She left her land. Did she give somebody to keep the land for her?
No.
Did she hand over the land to anybody?
No.
So, if you are the king and this woman came to you and said, King, I have been gone for 7 years and I left my land. I didn't lock the gate of my land. I left my house. I didn't lock it. Even the one that was locked, they burgled in this our instance. How much for the one you left it over? Now, if you're the king, please, how would you judge this case? Anybody who is king, who can judge this case? 7 years, we were staying in the famine. We endured the famine. You ran away. You abandoned your house, abandoned your property, abandoned everything. You left. 7 years after, you came back and said, King, I can see trespassers in my house and my land. Come and chase them away. Please, who is the king? Who will help me judge this matter? Any king that can help me judge this matter?
At best, to have mercy, I will just say, okay, I will take only your land and your...
Okay, this man is a merciful king. Any other person, truthfully? Hello? You left of your own accord. You abandoned sheep. Hello? You abandoned sheep. You left when the going was rough. When there's now good, you came back and you're asking for land. Land is gone. So that's it. You left. You abandoned sheep. We didn't force you to go. You said a man of God told you something. So go and ask the man of God for your land now. How far? So, let's follow on the story. And so she came to the king for her house and for her land. Verse 4. And the king talked with Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, saying, tell me, I pray thee, all the great things that Elisha had done. And it came to pass that as Gehazi was telling the king how he had restored a dead body to life, that behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life cried to the king for her house and for her land. And Gehazi said, my lord, O king, this is the woman and this is her son whom Elijah restored to life. Verse 6 is the key where I'm going to. And when the king asked the woman, she told him that, yes, I'm the woman. So the king appointed unto her a certain officer, saying, restore all that was ours and all the fruits of the field since the day that she left the land, even until now. Oh my God.
Hallelujah.
Oh my God. Let me break this down for you. So for the past 7 years, after she abandoned her estate, abandoned her farmland, some people went to the farm and started to farm and started to labor. They bought fertilizer. They bought seed. They paid the tractor. They paid the engineer. They did everything and they were farming. Year one, they got the harvest. Year two, they got the harvest. Year three, year four, year five, year six, year seven. And they were happy and said, even though this land was supposed to be a land of farming, but thank God that we had invested and we got the harvest. And they were about to go and take of the harvest. There came a decree that said, guys, you have all labored, but for this woman. There's no other definition of divine restoration but this. I need you to understand this. You know, I like for you to allow your imagination to run wild. This woman abandoned sheep. This woman went away. She left her land. Nobody chased her. She did not secure her land. She left it vacant. So people came. Saw land. Talonile. Nobody answered. They came onto the land. They began to farm the land. They invested in the land. And they brought harvest. And when they were about to eat harvest, the woman showed up. And there was a divine decree that said, this is the original owner of this harvest. May your enemy labor for you.
Amen.
Let me read some translations to you. NIV, listen to NIV. And the king said, give back everything that belonged to her, including all the income from her land, from the day she left the country until now. Meaning, if these guys who took over her land had eaten the income in year one, they must vomit it. If they had chopped the income of the land that they labored, they invested in the labor, they were going to vomit it because it was a decree from the king. Give back unto this man all that belonged to her, including all the income from the land. Listen to God's word translation. Restore all that is hers, including whatever her property produced from the day she left until now. Whatever her property produced. So if she had an estate and you want to put tenants there and you are collecting rent, every rent that you collected for the past 7 years, give it back to her. If she had cars and she left her car and you were using her car to do Uber, every week, every money you collected doing Uber for the last 7 years, give it back to her. May I prophesy to you? That is why I said to you, all I need of you this day.
day or this period is faith. That's all I need of you. Faith. May I prophesy that the same God who was able to turn around 7 years of famine, 7 years of waste, 7 years of loss, 7 years of total stagnation, in one day, by one decree, there was a restoration. May I prophesy to you, this same God will show for you. Amen. In the name of Jesus, Amen. May the Lord show for you. Amen. As he showed up for this woman.
Amen.
In insurance, it is called subrogation. So, took over. What was, because if you were to judge, quote unquote, rightly, at best, you say, okay, since you just came back now, we have to take your land and from today. Abi, we have to give you land. But it was not just take your land and from today. Everything the land ever produced for the past 7 years that the woman went away. How better can God orchestrate for you a restoration? Let me read New Century Version for you. Give the woman everything that is hers. Give her all the money you made from her land from the day she left until now. So everything you had labored and you had acquired and whatever, hand it over to her. May I say to you, that enemy who had taken what belonged to you and had thought that he had taken it for good and has been using it, by divine restoration, not only will there be a returning to you, but every profit from that will come back to you in the name of Jesus. So what does divine restoration mean? This is what it is. Divine restoration means you are reinstated to your pre-loss position. You are brought back to your state. What is beautiful or more beautiful than that? You are brought back to a state better than where it was before. Do you know that it is possible that the people that took over the woman's estate, they would have gone to hire people like Brother Lado, who is an expert, help us to build a mansion. Build it very nice because we want this thing to be earning the best income. So they have succeeded in building what? Mansion for the woman. The woman probably could not have built a mansion. Do you know that it's possible that the people that took over our land would have gone to get the best agri-economic or whatever person to come and farm the land to get the maximum return? The woman may not have been able to do that. So when there's divine restoration, there's a placing to a level or a pedestal better than where you were before. So therefore, that is why I know that 2020, the last 10 months may have been for you so much loss and ache and pain. But I decree by the word of the Lord, these last 2 months, what the Lord will restore to you, it will be much more than you have ever lost in the past 10 months. Divine restoration. The restoration comes without apparent input from you. No apparent input from you. You had nothing to do with it. When it is divine restoration, I'm not just saying ordinary restoration. When it is divine restoration, you will have absolutely nothing in it. It will just be God who will orchestrate all things, and you all you have to just do. So this woman, when she was going, she had built a house like this house we are seeing now when she left 7 years ago. By the time she came back 7 years after, they had plastered it, they had furnished it, they had done everything, and all she had to do was collect the key and enter. So she left the house in carcass. She came back well furnished, well garnished. May I say to you, your enemy will help you to garnish your house. No input from her. They were not allowed to take anything out of our property. Say, restore back unto her everything that belongs to her. Everything that our land produced belongs to her. Let me shock you. They could have brought their own property into the land. So they could have brought their own cars into the land. But as far as the car was now on our land, the car that they had, that they brought into the land, became what? Our own. May I say to you, when your enemy is going to restore to you, even his own property will be part of the things he will hand over to you. Yeah. That's the divine restoration. So, restoration comes without any apparent input from you. Restoration comes even if the initial loss was caused by your own negligence or your own action. Because this woman, she waka commode with her two legs. Nobody forced her. But because it is divine restoration, even the prayer of the mighty shall be taken away. Ah, Isaiah Amen. Chapter 45, chapter 49, verse 24 and 25. Even when you use your own hand to go and cause wahala, or you brought the issue upon yourself, can you project Isaiah 49, 24 and 25? Even when it was your own mistake that, you know, you messed up and then you went to commit abortion and you lost your womb. Yes, and the devil is feeling cool. But when God is going to restore, he will not only give you a womb, he will give you twins.
Amen.
That is what is called divine restoration. When you messed up, God told you not to do an investment. You went to do that investment and you did the investment and you dropped it and you lost your investment and you lost your principal son. When God does divine restoration, he will not only bring back your principal son, he will bring back the profit that you are supposed to make in that investment. Shall the prey be taken from the mighty, or the lawful captive? Lawful captive means that you were in captivity lawfully. They arrested you properly. You committed a crime and they arrested, so you're a lawful captive. Shall the lawful captive be delivered? Verse 25. But thus said the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible shall be delivered. For I will contend with them that contend with thee, and I will save their children, say the Lord. So, even the lawful captive, the one that you use your own leg to go and cause. I said that restoration, your divine restoration means that a restoration that displaces usurpers and trespassers. Everyone who has been trespassing upon your land, trespassing upon your peace, trespassing upon your joy, trespassing upon your wealth, trespassing upon your position, trespassing upon your lifting. Today, every trespasser and usurper, they are removed away.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So, divine restoration is a supernatural orchestration by God to take his children from a low level to a high level. Divine restoration is a supernatural orchestration. It is God that does it. If you are doing it, it is not divine. If it's based on your scheming, divine restoration is an orchestration by God himself to take his children from a low level to a high level. Every time there's a divine restoration, you are better than where you were before. Every time there's a divine restoration, you are better than where you were before. Divine restoration is a supernatural orchestration by God to take his children from a low level to a high pedestal. Now, may I say to you, now, divine restoration is multifaceted. There are so many dimensions to divine restoration. So, for instance, you can, and you will, not you can, you will express divine restoration of health, divine restoration of wealth, divine restoration of joy, divine restoration of gladness, divine restoration of freedom, divine restoration of liberty, divine restoration of affluence, divine restoration of influence, divine restoration of honor, divine restoration of dignity, divine restoration of family, divine restoration of position, divine restoration of property, divine restoration of years have been wasted, divine restoration of pregnancy, divine restoration of children, divine restoration of estate, and all dimensions of divine restoration. And I'll show you from scripture. If not today, next Sunday. So, divine restoration is God. You have no part there. He does it by himself. And he does it in a way that takes you to a position better than where you were before.
Yes, sir.
So, listen to me. It doesn't matter anyone who is sitting on what belongs to you right now. It doesn't matter the opportunities you have lost. It doesn't matter even if with your own disobedience you have missed God. But God is a God of second chances. And because he will do a divine restoration, not only would you be restored back to where you were, you will be restored back to a better position in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
So let's break some things down. When divine restoration comes, it comes with it spontaneous joy and laughter. Psalm 126, you are familiar with that, but let's read it. Spontaneous joy and laughter. Divine restoration will always bring along with it spontaneous joy and laughter. Psalm 126, verse 1 to 3. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, when there was a turning around, when there was a divine restoration, when the Lord turned the captivity of Zion around, we're like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the Edom, the Lord had done great things for them. The Lord had done great things for us, wherefore we are glad. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, I see God turning around any form of captivity of your life in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
There will be a divine restoration. When I made that dream, so they were filled with laughter and with joy. And even among the enemy was said that the Lord had done good for them. So divine restoration brings spontaneous joy and laughter. I told us that when divine restoration comes, it takes you beyond your initial state. Job chapter 42 and verse 10. When you encounter divine restoration, you are in a, your latter end is better than your beginning, your former end, because it is addition. God is a God of Jara. When God restores you, He restores you with Jara. Job chapter 42 and verse 10. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. The Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. That is why I say to you, God will give you double.
Amen.
For your trouble, you have double.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. I said also, divine restoration attracts crowd of well-wishers, and it also comes with a special package that everybody has in their hand. When there's divine restoration, just forget it, people will come. Now, when these people come, they will not just come empty and dead, they will come having in their hand a gift for you. Go to verse 11 of that Job chapter 42. This was a man who had already been blessed twice, but look at what happened in verse 11. Then came there unto him all his brethren. Question, where were his brethren before restoration? Hello? Where were his brethren? Because as far as we're concerned, it was only the wife that he mentioned when he was in suffering. Even his wife said, curse God and die. So everybody abandoned him, absconded, and forgot him. But when divine restoration came, they now remember that, Kai, we have a brother, we have an uncle, we have a friend called Job. May divine restoration bring people your way. Not only will they come, they will now come with their two eyes to see what God has done for you. That's what it is. They will now come to say, God has been good to you. Look at what happened. Then came unto him all his brethren and all his sisters and all that they had been and all they that had been of his acquaintance before, those that ran away. And they did eat bread with him in his house, and they bemoaned with him and comforted him over all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. Every man also gave him a piece of money, and everyone an earring of gold. Now, I find this very instructive. How come they didn't give him a piece of money or earring while he was in trouble? Well, because God wants to do it that he can take all the glory. Because if they had done that, they would boast and say, we're the one that brought you out of his predicament. May God not allow anyone to boast over your life.
Amen.
May God do it himself for you. And after you have received the double, they will come and come identify with you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So, divine restoration brings spontaneous joy and laughter. Divine restoration gives an extra one above what you had initially. And it attracts the crowd of well-wishers that deliver unto you a gift and some token. Now, quickly, I said that God is a God of restoration. God is in the business of restoring. That is why I know that this month, indeed, before the end of this year, everything you might have lost, every opportunity, every business contact, anything it is, by divine orchestration, if God, within a twinkle of an eye, restored back unto Job all that he had lost, if in 7 years this woman, the woman that we read about, had suffered so much loss, but by one day declaration, she received back 7 years loss. May I also prophesy to you that God will cause to come back to you everything good, everything pleasant, everything adorable, everything that is pleasurable for you that you have lost. May the Lord bring about a restoration in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So God is the God of restoration. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. God is a God of restoration. Joel 2, 25 and 26. Joel chapter 2. Verse 25 and verse 26. God is a God of restoration. and in your life, it will definitely restore your good in Jesus' name. Joel chapter 2, verse 25 and 26. Are you there? And I will restore unto you the years that the locusts had eaten. I thought somebody was saying to that.
Amen.
You see, when the Bible talks, you know, sometimes talk figuratively, what's the locust? The locust is devourer. Whatever has been a source of devourer for you, might be sickness. Or some people's sickness, you spend so much, you know, hospital bills. That is a devourer. For some people, it might be, you know, spend trip. You just spend anyhow. Money comes into your hand. But before you know, you don't know how you can't account for how you spend the money. That's a devourer. That's the locust. So God says, I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the cankerworm, the caterpillar, the palmerworm, my great army which has done unto you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied. And praise the name of the Lord your God that I dwell wondrously with you. And my people shall never be ashamed. That's divine restoration. May I say that this scripture will find practical expression in you in the name of Jesus. So quickly, let's just, for time, look at areas where God shows up and is a restorer. I said that God restores dead son. So if God can restore a dead son, God can restore a dead sentence. God can restore a dead womb. God can restore a dead brain. God can restore a dead business. Anything dead in your life, God will restore in the name of Jesus. 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. And we are familiar with the story of the Shunammite woman. That's the same woman, you know. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 27 to 37. But because of time, we'll just. Now, so this woman that through a prophet Elisha, God gave a son. One day, while he was in the field, he just. My head, and he died. And the Shunammite woman then decided to go after the prophet. And then verse 20, let's just drop to verse 32 because of time. And when Elisha was come into the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. And Elisha went thereon and shut the door upon them twain and prayed unto the Lord. And he went up and lay upon the child and put his mouth upon his mouth and his eyes upon his eyes and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched himself upon the child and flesh, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. Then he returned and walked in the house to and fro and went up and stretched himself upon him again. And the child sneezed sometimes, and the child opened his eyes. And he called Gehazi and said, call this Shunammite. So he called her, and when she was come in unto him, he said, take up thy son. Then she went in and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, for context, let me explain the story to you. This woman, Shunammite woman, was barren. But she was hospitable. Every time Elisha would pass a street, she would be looking, and one day she told her husband, let's build a guest room for this man of God. So he will be stopping up. So long story short, the woman built a guest house for Elisha, and Elisha was staying there. And Elisha said, what does this woman want? Turned out that she didn't have a child. And by the word of the Lord, through Elisha, she had a child. So God brought joy to her. And she had joy, she was happy and all of that. And the devil then chose to steal her joy. The devil then chose to mar her joy. The devil then chose to bring her back to her state of childlessness. And that was the plan of the devil. But thank God for God. She ran to Elisha, and Elisha prayed and restored the child. And so the woman was restored back to her state of joy again. So God is a God that restores dead son. Number two, he restores dead womb. Genesis chapter 30. God is still in the business of restoring womb. He said he's dead, that is dead and forgotten. God is still in the business of restoring dead womb. Genesis chapter 30, verse 22. Now, look at verse 31 before we go to, but I just want to establish something there. Look at verse, Genesis 29, 30. Let's look at something there. Genesis 29, 31. I want to show you something before we go to that place. Genesis 29:31. Are you there? Genesis 29:31. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. Can you see that? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Now, Rachel was barren. That's why, you know, remember I told you that even when with your own hands, you go and look for trouble. Because what happened here was that Jacob was doing favoritism. And because of Jacob's favoritism, Leah's womb was open, Rachel was barren. And that barrenness continued. But what happened? Now, go to Genesis 30:22. Genesis 30:22. And the Lord remembered Rachel, just as the Lord is remembering somebody today.
Amen.
And the Lord remembered Rachel. And it occurred to God that, wait a minute, Rachel has been barren. Not necessarily because of anything she did, but because of the favoritism that Jacob was showing. So even Jacob used his hand to bring trouble for Rachel. But the Lord remembered Rachel. And the Lord remembered Rachel, and God acted unto her and opened a womb. May I prophesy to somebody in the house this morning, the Lord will open your womb.
Amen.
Womb is symbolic, it's not only a physical womb. Womb speaks to birth. You know, you conceive, when you conceive ideas, conceive thoughts, conceive innovations, conceive thought. So it may not be natural or physical womb. I pray for somebody in the house this day. The Lord will open your womb, will open your ideas, will open your mind, will open your thought. And those that need physical opening, the Lord will also open your womb. So God specializes in restoring dead wombs. Genesis 18:10. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son, and Sarah heard it in the tent which was behind him. And it happened according to the word of the Lord that Sarah did conceive. I prophesy once again that the Lord will restore me dead womb in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
God is the restorer of withered hands. Mark 3:5. Again, this is symbolic or figurative. A withered hand is a hand that cannot hold money, that cannot hold business, that cannot. When your hands are withered, you cannot hold stuff. When your hand, you have leprosy, when your hands are totally chopped up, that means to say your hand cannot hold anything. So when God restores withered hands, it means that God restores your ability to profit with your hands. May I say to somebody, you will profit with your hands.
Amen.
Your hands will deliver profit unto you.
Amen.
Mark 3:5. So God is in the business of restoring withered hands. Any hand that has been withered before now, the Lord will restore in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Every withered hand, a hand that cannot do business, a hand that cannot hold profit, a hand that is just there, the Lord will restore in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Mark 3:5. And when he looked round on him, round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their heart, he said unto the man, stretch forth thy hand. As I said today, stretch forth your hand in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. May your hand be restored whole in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Your hand that was withered that did not allow you to profit. Your hand that was withered that did not allow you to do business. Your hand that was withered that did not allow you to make progress. Today, there shall be a restoration.
Amen.
So God is in the business of restoring withered hands. Number four. God is in the business of restoring health. Jeremiah 30:17. God is in the business of restoring health. Jeremiah 30:17. For I will restore health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds, saith the Lord. Because they call thee an outcast, saying, this is Zion, whom no man seeketh after. I will restore health unto thee and heal thee of thy wounds. God is still in the business of restoring health. So if you are sick in the body, if you are sick in your mind, if you are sick of any ailment, God is still in the business of restoring health unto you. And therefore I do know that every ailment, every sickness, every calamity, every, by whatever name it is so called, the Lord is taking them away and is restoring your health in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say the Lord is restoring your health in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So God is in the business of restoring your health. So don't carry sickness like a badge. Don't wear, say, in my headache comes like this, eh? In my menstrual pain comes like this, it is not your own. Stop claiming it. Leave the devil with it. It is not your own. Don't say, you don't know. In my family, I own this dizzy. When I start to be dizzy like this, the whole world will be turning. No, don't claim it's not your own. God will restore your health. He has restored your health already. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So God is in the business of restoring health. Quickly. God is in the business of restoring joy to a gloomy event. Is there an event that is gloomy? When God brings about restoration, joy comes. John chapter 2 and verse 10. You are familiar with the story of the marriage in Cana of Galilee. It was a joyous occasion. It was a marriage reception. It was a party. Fun. Then the substance of joy disappeared. And everybody was like, Kai, see this man. It was a show of shame and embarrassment to the man. Because people said, if you don't have money, why did you invite us to the wedding? But Jesus stepped in and there was restoration of joy. Look at verse 10. And he said unto him, that's the chairman of the occasion, after that they have given him the good wine. Every man at the beginning does set forth good wine. And when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. For thou hast kept the good wine until now. So joy was restored, but at a higher level, because it was not the good wine. May I prophesy to somebody, where joy has departed from you, where it looks as if your life is just gloomy and doomy and whatever it is, may the joy of the Lord be restored back unto you. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So God is in the business of restoring joy to a gloomy event. God is in the business of restoring joy to every situation. Psalm 30 and verse 5. Not just to an event, to your life. God is in the business of restoring joy to your life, so that you are bubbling with joy all the days of your life. Psalm 30 and verse 5. For his anger endured but a moment. In his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. I say to you, the joy of the Lord will restore back unto you.
Amen.
Where you are, your joy has been taken away. Where it looks as if you are just gloomy, you just life is just dealing with any blow on you. May the Lord restore your joy in the name of Jesus. Anywhere where the devil has stolen your joy, may the Lord restore your joy.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Isaiah chapter 57 and verse 18. Isaiah 57 and verse 18. May the Lord restore your joy. May your joy never cease.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Isaiah 57 and verse 18. I have seen his ways, and I will heal him, and I will lead him, and I will lead him also, and restore comfort unto him. May the Lord restore comfort unto you.
Amen.
And joy in the name of Jesus. Number whatever. God is in the business of restoring sight. Again, it's not just physical eye alone. Sight, wisdom, revelation, insight. Mark chapter 8 and verse 25. God is in the business of restoring sight. So where you have lost your sight, not physical eye alone, where you have lost the inner eye, inability to see, inability to perceive, inability to connect, where you have lost your sense of sight, where you have lost the sense of revelational sight, may the Lord restore unto you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Mark chapter 8, verse 25. Mark 8, 25. After that, he put his hands again upon his eyes and made him look up, and he was restored, and he saw every man clearly. He saw every man clearly. May you begin to see clearly.
Amen.
May the Lord restore your inner eyes.
Amen.
May the Lord restore your eyes of revelation.
Amen.
May the Lord restore may the Lord enlighten your eyes so you begin to see clearly.
Amen.
May you see opportunities. May you see business opportunities, areas that you will prosper, areas that you will profit.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. So the Lord restore his eyes. Not just physical eyes alone. So restoration, God is in the business of restoring sight. And the Lord restores sight. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The Lord is in the business of restoring fainting soul. A soul that is fainting and is dying and is giving up. You know that? Psalm 23 and verse 3. You're familiar with that. The Lord is in the business of restoring your fainting soul. Where you are fainting and where you think you don't have strength anymore. You think that God Kai, I can't carry on. He restored my soul. He leaded me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. May the Lord restore your soul.
Amen.
Where you think that you no longer have strength, where you think you can't make it, where you have given up and said, God, you know, maybe next year I'm tired, I can't fast anymore, I can't pray anymore, I can't do anything anymore. May the Lord restore your soul in the name of God. May the Lord inoculate you with faith in the name of Jesus. Restore the faith soul. Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. Verse 29 to 31. Isaiah chapter 40. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall tarry for it. Meaning, naturally speaking, there will be fainting. People will faint. Strength will fail them. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. That's restoration. There shall be a restoration of their strength. They shall mount up with wings as they go. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. That shall be your testimony in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That shall be your portion. You will not faint. You will not be weary. You will not break down in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You will mount up with wings as eagle. The Lord will renew your strength.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. So he restores faith in soul. Finally, because of time, the Lord also is in the business of restoring lost land. Now, when you talk about lost land, he's talking about opportunities. He's talking about resources. So it's not just the physical land. He said the Lord is in the business of restoring lost land. He's in the business of restoring your whatever, you know, is a resource for you. If, for example, you have an asset that you have lost, the Lord is in the business of restoring that. Jeremiah chapter 30 and verse 3. Jeremiah chapter 30 and verse 3. The Lord is in the business of restoring lost land. Jeremiah 30, verse 3. For lo, the days come, said the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, said the Lord. And I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to them, that I gave to their father, and they shall possess it. I will cause them to return back to their land. May you return back to your possession. May your asset return back unto you. Everything that is your source of resource, if what it is that you use to make money, to make what, may the Lord cause it to be restored back unto you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I will restore your land again.
Amen.
Jeremiah chapter 16 and verse 15. Same Jeremiah chapter 16 and verse 15. Jeremiah 16, 15. For the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all the lands whither he had driven them. And I will bring them again into their land that I gave unto their fathers. The Lord will bring you back into your own land, into your own wealth, into your own resource, in the name of Jesus. That which is yours originally, the Lord will bring you back there, in the name of Jesus. Zechariah chapter 10 and verse 6. Zechariah chapter 10 and verse 6. So bring you back to your own land is speaking to bringing you back to your own resource. Zechariah chapter 10 and verse 6. And I will strengthen the house of Judah, and I will save the house of Joseph, and I will bring them again to place them, for I have mercy upon them, and they shall be as though I have not cast them off, for I am the Lord their God, and I will hear them. It will be as though I have not cast them off, I will bring them back again. Can we rise up on our feet? We'll continue next Sunday. We'll look about Nebuchadnezzar. I'm sure you are familiar with the story of Nebuchadnezzar. We'll see how God is a God of restoration. He's a restorer. Slide upon your feet. We're going to pray one simple prayer point. I told us, I said that all I ask of you is please have faith. We're going to pray one prayer point, and the prayer point is simple. Oh Lord, restore back unto me everything I have lost in the past 10 months. Between 1st of January to 31st of October, let there be a restoration back unto me in the name of Jesus. Lift up your voice and pray. Let there be a restoration in the last 60 days of this, in fact, less than 60 days. Lord, restore back unto me. Man soto de baba, rese koto riska, limpa sakato de boska, reso koto de baba, man sakato de bo, restore back unto me, O God. Let there be a restoration. Everything good, my land, my
my joy, my wealth, my family, my wife, my husband, my children, my pregnancy, my business, my promotion, whatever it is that I've lost, oh God. Whatever it is that COVID-19 has taken away from me, let there be a restoration, oh God. Lift up your voice and pray. My academics, my progress, Lord, whatever it is, my health, whatever it is that the devil has stolen, I'm reaping back that what the love, what the God has promised me. I take back my possession. I possess my possession. There shall be a restoration. Mansoto de Bazi Braseketon Darabaski Zaroba Sakatone Bashakara Rime Seketon Dolobo Rahisa Pande Lebodoskia Masokoto de Baba Lime Sakatambe Lebo Rima Sakatalababa. Lord, I receive back every opportunity that I've lost, every business that has gone south, I receive back every investment that has gone south, I receive back the 100% I receive back in the name of Jesus. Everything that has been stolen from me, I receive back today, oh God, in the name of Jesus. I claim back my wealth, I claim back my resources, I claim back my joy, I claim back my position. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praised.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we have learned from your word. You are the God that restores. You are the business of restoring. What is it that we have lost? Opportunities, resources, wealth, time, marriage, children, whatever it is that we have lost. Today, the same way that you restored back the Shunammite woman, not only did you give back her land, everything that the land had produced for the past 7 years, you gave it back to her. Lord, today, we hold on to this same word. I will ask you, same God, that you gave Job twice what he had lost. As from today, everything good that we have lost, we will receive back multiple fold in the name of Jesus. We will receive back multiple fold of our joy, of our peace, of our happiness, of our resources, of our wealth, of our promotion, of our business opportunities, of jobs, of fruitfulness, of lifting, of increase, of enlightenment, of all kinds in the name of Jesus. Lord, we claim it. We receive it, O God. Our faith is inoculated. Our faith level is high. Let there be performance, O God.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, we are prayed.
Amen.
Join us together for the Lord. Let's take your seat. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank God for that. We'll continue on Sunday by God's grace. Let's take our offering. If you're attending the house, you can also drop your offering. Let's provide. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the seat in our hands. Accept our offering, accept our seed. Lord, we ask God that you use this for the expansion of your kingdom. Let the seed of God bring about a multiple fruit for us. As we sow the seed of God, it shall provoke a restoration of our finances. Where our finances have been messed up, where we are in debt, let this seed of God provoke a restoration to be debt free in the name of Jesus. Lord, help us, O God, able to acquire, to possess, and to dominate in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the Lord. Let's give our offering joyfully, cheerfully, for God loves the cheerful giver.
Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever.
Basket as well, and we thank God for the seed of tithing. Thank God for for the blessings that have put the title. God surely do us good in the mighty name of Jesus. We'd like to announce, we know that we're coming to the end of the year, and we thank God because we know that definitely God will crown our year with his goodness, his bounty, and of course, divine restoration will testify in the mighty name of Jesus. So if you have testimonies, I know we have testimonies. I know before the end of this year, we'll have loads of testimonies. We'd like you to put your testimonies down. We have the testimony slips on the last Sunday of this month, which is on the 29th of November. We're going to also have a testimony time. So we'll give, you know, opportunities for testimonies. But if you know, you're also the shy type, because we know some people don't want to put up their hands. You can write your testimony. We have the slips available, and then you can send it over. And for those of us online as well, we know that God has been good. So please send in your testimonies to us. The addresses or the lines to send it to, I'm sure will be scrolled for us to do that. We'd love to hear from you because we know that God is doing you good. God is doing us good, and will testify in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Please join us for our midweek service. Run that online, or stream online on Facebook and Instagram. The time is 6 p.m. and it's time to be time to equip ourselves with the word of God. This month of divine restoration, in the mighty name of Jesus, all that God has in store for us, will not miss it in the name of Jesus. Will not miss God in the mighty name of Jesus. So tune in on Wednesday, 6 p.m. and God surely will locate you with his word and will give you a testimony in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Also, the last Sunday of this month, every last Sunday of the month, we have an outreach by our Father in the Lord. It's called Say to Me, O Lord. And it's streamed live on Facebook. We also have a fiscal meeting as well at number 42 Association Avenue by Obanikoro Bus Stop in Lukweji. But if you're not able to join us physically, you can join us online. We streamed on Facebook. Say to me, O Lord, small letter, one word. And the Lord will settle you and do you good in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Please, we'd also like to encourage us, all of us, let's continue to pray for our nation. Please, this is a time not to give up. There are a lot of battles, spiritual battles, going on for the soul of Nigeria. Please, let's not, and it is for us Christians, it is for us that believe that we have a God that is big enough, a God that his hands are big enough to move the world. We are going to not give up in the place of prayer. Yes, we hear a lot of discouraging things. I hear a lot of things. People say things like, oh, we have been praying all these days. What has God done? Please don't be discouraged. Prayer moves the hand of God, and the hand of God always moves the world. So let's not be discouraged. Continue to pray for Nigeria. You may not be seeing what is going on, but please pray. Pray. If it's just a few minutes, 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes, or as the Lord leads your heart, pray for the soul of this country. And in the mighty name of Jesus, brand new country will be rock, the one that God will be glorified in the mighty name of Jesus. And anytime you know God is glorified, his children are blessed as well. So let's not give up where our country is concerned. It shall be well with us in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Is there anyone worshiping with us for the first time? Any first timer in the house? We'd like to welcome you. All right. You're welcome. Oh, my brother, you're welcome. God bless you.
Into the King.
Wherever you do not know that God is working, God will begin to open your eyes and you begin. begin to see God move in your life in a new dimension in the mighty name of Jesus. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. You're welcome. Please have your seats. After the meeting, our counselor will see you and she'll tell you more about us and you can ask her more questions about us. God bless you once again. You're welcome.
Hallelujah. Amen. Have you been blessed?
Yes, sir.
Are you restored?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Let's have our meeting as we close the service. I am persuaded that the God who has decreed and declared in November 2020 as a season of divine restoration would make you experience this practically in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I prophesy to you, by the word of the Lord and by the mandate of God, every word of prophecy has gone out, every prayer, every declaration, every positive confession will find practical manifestation in you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I speak to you as you go forth today and this week, there shall be restoration of your joy, restoration of your peace, restoration of your good, restoration of your finances, restoration of relationships in the name of God. Every relationship has been strained. I command there to be a restoration in the name of Jesus. For somebody here this week, there shall be a restoration with some old classmate of yours, some old classmate of yours that will do you good in the name of Jesus. Someday you come and testify with a linking with an old classmate that God will restore back that relationship or restore back that friendship, and that will lead to you a profitable relationship in the name of Jesus. I speak and I declare that your health is restored. No more sickness, no more up today, down tomorrow. In the name of Jesus, it is well with you. Go forth and prosper. Go forth and excel. Go forth and enjoy the fullness of what the Lord has in store for you. Sickness, calamity, accidents, lack, failure, they are not your portion. The Lord will keep you. The Lord will preserve you from every armor, from every danger. The covenant of life that we enjoy in the King's chamber shall continually speak for all. In the name of Jesus, you are dominating. You are more than a conqueror. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Shall we share the grace together? The love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Then abide with us forevermore. Amen. Surely, God's goodness ever shall follow us all the days of our lives. We shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 16, verse 11. For the Lord will show us the path of life. For his presence is fullness of joy. And at his right hand, they are pleasures forevermore. Shalom, members online. The Lord bless you. See you on Wednesday in Jesus' name. Shalom, God bless you.